It's very okay. It's very okay. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. It's very good to see you all here. So now we can resume with the second lecture.
It's okay. Okay, Guido is a specialist in the determination of the all the parameters and the faces of the unitarity triangle for the CKM. And, you see, and, in fact, there is a group that they explicitly they call themselves the CKM fitting group, something like that. Okay, anyway, and probably you see there is a combination of triangles there. Anyway. Yesterday, I finished with the program for today, which is associated. Okay, what is this? No. It's not working. No? Okay, I can do it here. No, the. I don't know whether it's the battery or whatever. No. Okay. Yeah, as always, yeah. Thank you very much. Good. Okay, this is the program that I was mentioning. Associated with the same philosophy. That means how the theory for the electroweak interactions, and not only for the interaction, and the particle content which is associated with these interactions are completely guided in all the aspects by the problems associated with symmetries and symmetry breaking, okay? And you have here the program. It's not necessary to comment about this. Everything started in connection with these arguments, with parity violation. You see, in the 50s, it was pointed out by Lee and Yang that no measurement in the traditional studies on nuclear beta decay, you see, the process which is the first process in which the weak interaction were observed, no observable was able up to that moment to say whether parity was an exact symmetry of nature or not. The importance is not the question, but okay, the question is important, of course. But you see, the importance of the paper of Lee Yang is that first they demonstrated that what I was saying, that there was no observable before, okay, that could answer the question about the possible violation of parity. And second, how to do it. And in fact, the argument of Walt Electric is always that they explain so well how to do it in nuclear beta decay that the colleague of Lee Yak in Columbia, Madame Bu, make the experiment immediately in nuclear beta decay with polarized nuclei in order to have an asymmetry in the angular distribution of the electrons able to distinguish left from the right. Okay, much easier than this for explaining parity violation and also charge conjugation violation is the study of the pi decay, the pion decays. And in fact, experimentally, the results for pion decays were published only a few months later than the result of Madame Bou on nuclear beta decay. And you see, in that case, the explanation is very simple about the meaning of this, only studying the different pi decays that you can have. You see, about the discrete symmetries, I start with parity, as I was saying, and at the same time, charge conjugation. Parity corresponds to this mirror image of the corresponding processes, and the charge conjugation has nothing to do with properties in ordinary space-time, but only the internal properties of charges, okay? You go from particles to antiparticles in that case. Then if you start, okay, I was saying, with this pi plus decay into mu plus and muon neutrino. By the way, this question of chirality that I will comment immediately is crucial in that case to explain why the pi meson decays to muons and does not decay to electrons. Okay, in principle, you have more phase space in the decay to electrons, and people claim that there is electron muon universality and things like that. Okay, why the pion decays to muon is not decaying to electrons? Okay, you see here immediately the pi decays to mu plus because of the pi plus to mu plus because of charge conservation, and then in flavor conservation that corresponds to the neutrino in the other side. Okay, the neutrino is left-handed. I mentioned the Goldhaber experiment measuring the helicity of the neutrino. And okay, it's left-handed. This corresponds to helicity left, which means that really the spin component is in the sense that I have represented all is opposite to the momentum. Okay, this is the momentum, the opposite. Okay. Because of conservation of momentum, then you have the mu plus that way, but the conservation of angular momentum tells you, okay, that the spin of the mu is in this other sense, which corresponds, again, to opposite direction to the momentum for the spin. This is very odd, because the mu plus is the antiparticle, and the mu plus likes to have in weak interactions chirality right-handed. Okay, that means there is a mismatch. Okay, the muon is massive, and chirality and helicity is not the same thing. I will repeat today many times this sentence. It's not the same thing, but okay, in the limit of zero mass, they are the same. And then the mu plus would prefer to have helicity right-handed, the mu plus. However, it has also helicity left-handed, okay, as you see there. It's necessary because the total helicity has to be zero. It's the difference of helicities for one particle and to the other. The pion has no spin, okay, in that case. Okay, this is precisely the argument why the pion decays to the muon and not to the electron, okay, because you need the mass in order to have the mismatch between chirality and helicity. And then electron is very light, the muon is more massive, and then because of this mismatch, okay, is a chiral argument, then the pion goes dominantly to muons and with very small probability to electrons, okay, in the decay. Then parity. Parity corresponds to the mirror image. You put all the arrows that you have there just in the opposite sense. And then the conclusion of this is that the pi plus because of parity should decay to mu plus here, and the neutrino now to the left. And then when you see what happens for parity the momentum changes sign, but the spin is not changing sign. That means the neutrino should have also the spin in that direction. Then you compare with the momentum, that means now the neutrino is elicited right-handed. Okay? And, okay, whatever for the mu plus in that case. Then you look for this process. The decay of the pi plus into the mu plus with this configuration, the one in which the you can measure the polarization of the muon in order to see what happens, has to be also elicited right-handed in that case. And this doesn't exist in nature. You start from a process existing in nature, you transfer by parity, you go behind the mirror, and then there is nothing behind the mirror. The process doesn't exist. That means not only parity is violated, it's violated at the maximal effect. Yes. That means in pi decay, this is fantastic to test the symmetry. The process here to the right doesn't exist. Instead of parity, you transform the process by charge conjugation. Then the arrows are the same, you know, see? In one, in these upper lines and the bottom lines, okay? The arrows are the same, the only thing you change the charges of everything. And the result, again, should be that if charge conjugation is a good symmetry for this process, then the pi minus should decay to the mu minus and neutrino with these elicities that are present there. Again, this process doesn't exist in nature. If you transform by the combination of charge conjugation times parity, Cp, then you have to do both things. Not only changing the charges, but also changing the arrows in the sense of the mirror, the arrows for the momentum, not for the case of the spin. The spin is not changing. Elicity is changing under parity. Elicity, but elicity is not the spin. Elicity is a spin projected on momentum, okay? And this is changing the sign, the elicity, because of the momentum factor, not because of the spin. Okay, and again, you measure this process, and then you observe that the probability of the decay is exactly the same as in the case of the original decay. The conclusion is that parity is violated, charge conjugation is violated, Cp is conserved by weak interactions. The result was published in 1957, you see, a few months later than the publication of Madame Bou in nuclear beta decay. This experiment was projected and performed by Lederman, Walter Legdi, and collaborators in that case. Okay. But the Nobel Prize in that case was given to the theorist. There was no competition between Madame Bou and this other experiment for pi decay. Time reversal. Time reversal, you know that you are not changing the position coordinates, you change the sign, the momentum, which is equivalent to, that means that you change also the spin components, but this is equivalent of changing, normally I say delta t into minus delta t. One has to be careful because in some books you find t going to minus t. I think this is nonsense. The delta, you put the delta as another thing. The time, you see, there is an arrow of time. There is an arrow of time. The time is always in the same positive direction. You cannot evolve, you see, to the past. It's not t into minus t. It's delta t into minus delta t. The meaning that you have to exchange initial and final state. That means it's a difference of two times. Okay, and what you are changing is that the role of the initial and the final state. That this motion reversal. This is the idea of time reversal. Okay, chirality. Okay, I mentioned already chirality, but chirality is associated with parity. But one is talking about two different things. One is the transformation in ordinary space for parity. And the other is what is the operator that is implementing this operator or transformation in general, okay, that is implementing this parity transformation in the space all the states. In the case of the fermions, on the spinors, the Dirac spinors, in that case. Okay, what I wrote here, the chiral phenomenon is not identical to the mirror image. The spin of a particle may be used to define the handedness, okay, one in the other, and it's represented there. Okay, that means exactly, okay, what is the sense of the handedness that you have in this situation. But this is not, this is elicity, okay? This is elicity. That means this kind of handedness is associated with elicity. What is chirality is what happens to a Dirac fermion when really you want to transform with this property of going from the left to the right. In Dirac space, you have the gamma matrices. And it was Salam, very early, that discovered the gamma 5. The paper of Salam with the gamma 5 was not published. Again, as what I said yesterday about this white paper on core model. You see, Pauli said that there was no chance to talk about parity transformations and things of this kind, because it was clear that nature was, you see, exactly conserving this this symmetry. Okay. Anyway, and what you can do with the gamma 5, make this chiral transformation. And in order to distinguish in Dirac space with the gamma matrices, what is the chirality left and chirality left, then it's clear. Okay. In transformation theory, you project. And the corresponding projector to the left is 1 minus gamma 5, and the transformation to the right is 1 plus gamma 5. You can immediately make a check of this. If you, on this projected state, you apply the gamma 5, the result is minus 1. If you apply to the other state the gamma 5, then the result is plus 1. Okay? Left-handed, right-handed chiralities for this. What happens in weak interactions after the results of the experiment is that parity has to be violated, which means that in the case of the fermions, you see, chirality left and chirality right have to have different transformation properties under parity. That means that you have to distinguish left from right. There is no symmetry in that case. That means if you build a field theory to describe the weak interactions, then automatically in this theory, the transformation properties of the left spinors, these transformation properties have to be different from the transformation properties of the right spinors. Okay? This is a consequence of symmetry, just an illustration of what I was saying. It's not only the fact that you see, you have the charges and what are the corresponding charges, but chirality is fundamental in order to build a gauge theory for electroweak interaction. And the violation of parity, not the chirality as an exact symmetry, but precisely in a symmetry which is 100% broken, okay? From a process that exists to another process that the probability is zero, okay? Transformed by parity. And this is what happened in the formulation of Glashow, Weinberg, and Salam theory for the gauge theory of electroweak interactions. That is a chiral theory, in the sense that the left-handed spinors, okay, the 1 minus gamma 5 psi, have properties under the gauge group of electroweak interactions that they are doublets under SU2. And the right spinors are singlets. That means that they don't see the interaction. The right spinors, the weak interaction that is associated to that. Okay, doublets under SU2, singlets under SU2, when you talk about the left spinors and the high spinors. That means the gauge theory of electroweak interactions has to be a chiral theory. Okay, then the next. Okay, the theory is built, as you know, and this is not a course about the standard model. This is a course about the symmetries that are necessary for that, okay? But I remind you the main properties that are associated to that. The gauge group in that case is SU2 times U1. That means you have a coupling constant for the SU2, Okay, this is equivalent to the coupling constant we had yesterday for the SU3O color, okay, one coupling constant. And you have a coupling constant G prime for the case of the U1. Then, because it's a SU2, you have three mediators, the W plus, the W0, the W minus, in the regular representation in a triplet, okay, in words, everything is clear, okay, not necessary to put formula. And then the U1, this is exactly like the B, the U1 of hyperchargeds, the weak hyperchargeds in that case, like the photon in the case of QED. But in order to have an exact symmetry, you see, everything has to be massless. A master, independent of what is the origin of the master, okay, automatically breaks the gauge symmetry. But you know that weak interactions are short range, and then the mediators have to be massive. Okay, the origin of the masses of these mediators will be discussed in 2 days, okay, not today. But whatever is the origin, okay, you have masses, then automatically you have to distinguish between the gauge mediators, okay, the W0 and the B, and the mediators with definite mass, okay, because there is this breaking of this gauge symmetry. The mediators with definite mass are well known, the Z, these are the physical particles, the Z and the gamma and the photon, okay, in that case. And then you have to have this mixing between the gauge states, the B and the W3 or W0, and the states with definite mass, which are the gamma and the Z0. Okay, and this mixing with the W, which is the word for the weak mixing angle, the W in the mixing, and this is represented here, okay, with this GG prime orthogonal SU2 times U1, you make this rotation by the weak mixing angle, okay, with the from the W0 to the Z with the angle theta, the same angle theta here in the other, this one, between the electromagnetic and the B that is present there. Okay, that means that the corresponding coupling for the electromagnetic interaction is the electric charge, the corresponding coupling for the weak neutral currents are this square root of G. Okay, this is a triangle, then Pythagoras, then automatically you have what is the coupling for the weak neutral currents. Okay, that means this theory as such, with this argument, automatically predicts that there should be weak neutral currents. In the late 60s and beginning of the 70s, it was clear to everybody that neutral currents didn't exist. Not that had not been discovered, no. People were convinced that neutral currents, weak neutral currents didn't exist. That means this interaction mediated by the Z, okay, is a product of the theory that should not be correct. Okay, and then at CER, there was an experiment on bubble chamber, the Gargamel experiment, that had been approved completely independent of all these theoretical arguments that I have presented here, to repeat with neutrino beams what MIT SLAC were doing for the probe of the proton, deep inelastic scattering that we discussed yesterday, to probe the structure of the proton with leptons, instead of having electrons, with neutrinos. That was, you see, the smoking gun for the Gargamel experiment. Neutrino deep inelastic scattering on hadronic systems in order to look for that. Okay? In fact, the question on neutral currents, you see, you put in a smoking gun as the motivation in order to get the approval of the committee, and then beyond that, you have another argument. And in the position, I think was the seventh position in this list, was the possibility of weak neutral currents, okay? Anyway, Gargamel, at the end, was important for the discovery of weak neutral currents by the young people of the experiment. Was the first experiment in which the experimentalist used simulation in order to demonstrate that the neutral current events that they were seeing were not induced by neutrons. And the proof was completely clear, not only in the number of events that you can discuss, what is the background of neutrons that you have, but in the energy distribution of the hadronic system at the end, which is completely different for reaction induced by neutrinos and for neutrons. Okay, neutral currents were discovered at CERN in 1973, okay, with the Gargamel bubble chamber experiment. And okay, there were a few events on electrons, but the main arguments came from the hadronic system, in fact, with the structure of the proton, okay? Going to, you see that the experiment is very difficult because it's for neutral currents, okay? That means you have neutrinos, you see only the hadronic system in the final state here, okay? You have the beam of neutrinos and then this. And not only that, 10 years later, with the SPBAR-PES, that means the collider, the first collider with antiprotons at CERN, in 1983, the W and the Z were discovered. And there was the Nobel Prize to Carlo Rubi and van der Meer. By the way, van der Meer got the Nobel Prize with an internal note written in the division of the accelerators at CERN. There was no publication, okay? Where he got the Nobel Prize. That means, okay, for this argument, the number of citations, and then this is irrelevant, okay? For a big discovery, what matters is to prove that the discovery was the first and so important and so relevant on that. Okay, I said that this was a collider experiment, antiprotons with protons, okay, using the stochastic cooling of van der Meer, and that means corresponded at the hard process with the elementary constituents, the UD bar producing a W plus, and then reconstructing in the final state, you see the W plus. And here is even easier because you have two charged leptons in the final state. And then you reconstruct the Z from the annihilation UU bar or DD bar. Okay, these experiments were UA1 and UA2 at CERN, and the publication is in 1983. That means neutral current exists, Gargamel, and the mediators exist. 10 years later. That was the great triumph of the standard model of electroweak interactions.
This is the other one.
Okay. Why not we look a little bit more for neutral currents against all the expectations that... Why people were thinking that neutral currents could not exist in the case of weak interactions? You see, you take the weak interaction not only of the UDs that I was commenting, but also the case of the strange particles. The strange particles existed, and yesterday we were talking, okay, since the 60s of the 20th century with UDS flavors, okay? And there was a Kabibbo theory corresponding to the fact that there is a rotation for weak interactions in starting from the DS flavors, in such a way that there is a combination in this rotation, the Kabibbo angle, and that corresponds to a given probability with the rotation cosine theta of this Kabibbo angle, and for the decay of the strange particles with the sine in the amplitude sine squared in the probabilities for the decay, okay? And then this was very well known. And you can explain the decays of the K plus into pi plus pi zero, for example, very well, okay, with this recipe, comparing the magnitude of the strangeness conserving weak interactions, the strangeness changing weak interactions, okay, in the relation of the given by the Kabibbo angle. Okay, then you have the three flavors, UDS and the Kabibbo theory. Then you have a symmetry, a gauge symmetry in the theory, which is SU2. Then you take cosine theta D plus sine theta S for the charge weak interaction. And now you apply isospin to see what will be the corresponding combination for the neutral component, okay? The W0, if you want, in terms of the W0 interaction, the neutral current at the level of the gauge mediators. And the result that you obtain is different from zero. Okay? In that case, different from zero. Then, if you have the result different from zero, this decay of the K long, which is a neutral K, neutral, going to mu plus mu minus, should have essentially the same probability within the same order of magnitude than ordinary weak interactions. Already at that time, in the 70s, you see, the branching ratio for this decay had a limit less than 10 to the minus 7. 10 to the minus 7 compared to the decay. You see that this is a neutral current interaction changing strangeness, because is the K0 is a combination of the strange and the D, the S and the D quarks in that case. That means, you see, this prediction is clearly against the experiment. And in fact, I know very well all this history because with my colleague Paco Indurain, we were a complete summer at CERN trying to understand within the theory and only three flavors what could be the solution. And at the end, there was no solution. Okay? That means I lost. I lost this. Okay? It's one of the things with Paco that we didn't get. The solution came in a different way. The gym mechanism, Glashow, Iliopoulos, and Mayani. The point is that you get this neutral current, the trend is conserving neutral currents, because this, if you want a symmetry that you have between the UD and the S and nothing else. That means flavor SU3. And Glashow already with Jorgen had speculated, Jorgen and Glashow both, the possibility of having a fourth quark. Okay, the chart. Okay, and then in this paper, Glashow, Iliopoulos, and Mayani, they organize and reinterpret the Cabibbo mixing in a different way. If you put two doubles with a new quark, the char quark, then in that case, you see to the U, the coupling will be the Cabibbo coupling. Okay, that means the combination cosine theta D minus sine theta D. But for the char, should be the orthogonal. Okay, that means with this unitary metric should be sine theta for the D and cosine theta for the S in the decays of the char, okay, in that situation. And when you have that combination, then from the charge currents that are the ones that I mentioned, and you go to the neutral current, okay, because of the symmetry SU2 that you have in the gauge symmetry for weak interaction. And if this is a unitary matrix, 2 by 2, orthogonal matrix, in fact, okay, then in going to neutral currents, because of unitarity, then the result is 1. That means not only, you see what happens in that case is that the neutral currents are in such a way that there could be neutral current, but they have to be flavor conserving because it's proportional to 1. You cannot have a neutral current DS. That means, contrary to the first line, in the gym mechanism, the DS is absent. The result is the identity. That means neutral currents have to be not only flavor conserving, but also flavor equal for all of them, universal. Okay? Universal neutral current, proportional to the identity. Diagonal and universal. In that case, flavor conserving neutral current. That means that automatically the neutral currents that were observed later, because this paper is of 1970, okay? And that the neutral current observed by Gargamel were possible, but however, in the case of the K long, should be absent. Okay, but there is a point, should be absent at three level, because this argument is in tangent. Which is the one that is symmetric. However, once you go to loops in the theory, to the quantum theory of the electroweak interactions, then automatically flavor change in neutral currents can be induced. And can be induced if you have that the partners of the corresponding particles that you have for this transition. For example, the DS, okay, we were talking about the K-long, that means the KS, what you have here. This is the K-long, okay? The DS in the combination. In that situation, you can induce if the partner, that means the U, the C, okay, at that moment the U and the C, nothing else. Okay, we know these days that you have to put also third family, but I'm using the argument of that moment. If you put that and these two guys are not degenerate, you need this condition, okay? Then automatically in the calculation of this loop, because the W is massive, it has longitudinal components. You see, with photons, this is impossible. For Ws and the Zs, you have longitudinal components because they are massive. And the longitudinal component is very different from the transverse components of the vector bosons. Okay? The longitudinal components of this W generate automatically masses in the numerator in such a way that if the char and the up quarks are not degenerate, then automatically this difference appears in the loop. That means weak neutral currents are possible. Changing the flavor at loop level, but not only loop level, but there is a suppression that is given by this factor that is present there. That means the gym mechanism is giving you a possibility of having the decay of the K-long going to mu plus mu minus, this diagram, but very much suppressed, not only because it's a loop, but also because of these factors that appear in the calculation of the loop. Few years later, the decay was observed. The decay was observed at the level of 10^-9. 10^-9. Gym suppressed flavor changing neutral currents. Everything in order. Okay? And not only this, from the point of view of the prediction of the char quark, only 1 year after the Gargamel discovery of the weak neutral currents, there was the November Revolution in the United States with the result from Slack and Brookhaven about the J-psi method. You see, in the case of Slack with the E plus E minus machine, and in Brookhaven with the proton machine, in that case. Okay, and they discovered the states of the J psi, which these charmonium states that are really without charm because it's CC bar states. Okay, really the mesons that contain a charm different from zero as a result of the structure in terms of the quarks, like for example D C or C or whatever, were discovered later. You see in different laboratories, including CERN. Okay. Questions. Gym mechanism, flavor changing neutral currents are possible, but they are very much suppressed.
Question, who wants to ask?
Nothing? Okay. We come now to a new, a completely different question related also to weak interaction. Before, I discussed that in the decay of the pion, you see, parity was violated, charge conjugated was violated, and the CP transformation on the original state led, original process led to a process that was also allowed. CP symmetry, you see, means the following, that if you make a combined transformation of charges from antiparticles, from particles to antiparticles, and at the same time you go to the mirror image in a space, then parity transformation, then the dynamics should be the same. Perfect in pi decays. However, you see, there was a big surprise in 1964. I already told you that my historical discussions are not chronological. I'm again in the 60s, okay? In 1964, nobody had discussed, you see, this is really one of these experimental results that were not thought by anybody before, okay? The the mixing of the K0, K0 bar, you see, this argument that is the best system in order to understand all the intricacies of quantum mechanics, okay? With all the properties of the quantum amplitudes, okay? In the language of John Bell, you see, what is characteristic of quantum mechanics is not talking about probabilities, but about probability amplitudes, okay? I mean, this is the point, that probabilities do not act like the classical probability, probability amplitude. Okay, this kind of interference effects were seen in the mixing of the K0, K0 bar. And much later, but I put here, they were interpreted these effects in terms of the precisely what I mentioned in the previous transparency. That means that you could have this box diagram in that case in order to convert a strangeness plus one into a strangeness minus one, okay, with this box diagram and the two tuples. But whatever is, okay, the theory, you see the mixing existed and the physical, because K0, K0 bar without mixing are degenerate. When you put the mixing, automatically you generate two states, the K long and the K short, that they have maximal mixing. It's like, this is a course of quantum physics. And this is one of the arguments that what I was saying, that you learn a lot with this system. When you have a degenerate situation at the leading order, okay, and you put the perturbation, doesn't matter what is the magnitude of the perturbation, what is the mixing. Once you put the mixing between K0 and K0 bar for two degenerate states, then automatically the mixing in the states becomes 100%. Okay, that means there should be two states, non-degenerate, okay, K0 plus K0 bar, and the other K0 minus K0 bar. This, if CP is conserved, because CP is transforming K0 into K0 bar. Okay? What experimentally one observes is that one of them, one of these neutral kaons, you see, has a very long lifetime. And the interpretation was very clear. You see, the decay of the kaons is to two pions. In the two pions automatically doesn't matter whether it's pi plus, pi minus, or pi zero, automatically has a CP eigenvalue equal plus. Okay? If you have the situation of the K long lifetime, to pi plus should not go, because K plus long lifetime because is CP equal minus, cannot go to CP equal plus if you have CP conservation. Okay, then Cronin and Fitch in 1964, okay, yesterday I think I commented this point. They look for the branching ratio of the K long into two pions, and that was a big surprise. At the level of 1 per mil, a process that should be forbidden, zero probability, if CP is conserved, got a branching ratio of 1 per mil. The argument is very clear. It's a consequence of the conservation laws, the first traditional argument for the symmetries. Nothing special. Okay? Something that should be conserved, which is the CP eigenvalue of the initial and the final state, here is not valid. You see, the K long should be CP equal minus, pi plus is CP equal plus, and however, you have a branching ratio of 1 per mil. The consequence is that there should be CP violation, and the fact that K long is not 100% that I said K0 minus K0 bar. Okay? There is, okay, something associated in these relative amplitudes of K0, K0 bar for the K long that is associated with CP violation. Question. In this theory that I was commenting before, with SC2 times U1, the standard model, okay, is it possible to incorporate CP violation? And then, if you have two families, like in the gym mechanism, with the charm already, and already discovered in 1973, 74, in the 70s, this is impossible. You cannot incorporate in that theory CP violation. Why? Because in this unitary matrix, in the 2x2, if you put by hand faces that they can be the origin of a CP violation, automatically you can reabsorb these faces into a redefinition of the fields of the quarks. Okay? That means what sometimes is called the faces rotated away. Okay? That means you can reface the states of the quarks and then the faces disappear. However, Kobayashi Maskawa, already in 1973, before many of these questions, had already discussed that there is the possibility in the standard model to generate physical faces. That means faces in the mixing or associated with the different flavors. If you had at least three families, then you count what is the number of faces that you have in a unitary matrix in that case, and how many faces you can reabsorb. The counting is very easy. Okay, you can do it even with n families. Okay, it's not only for the case of the three. In the case of the three, there is one face that remains that should be physical, and this face could be the origin of CP violation in the standard model. Okay. At the moment that that Kobayashi Maskawa presented this argument, there was no evidence for a third family, of course. That means that people were thinking that perhaps CP violation, because in the case of the Keion system, CP violation, the numbers that you have, one per mil, very small, could come from interactions beyond the weak interaction. For example, Wolfenstein wrote the paper about super weak interactions. That means that the kind of interactions that could be responsible for effects of the CP violation. Okay. The argument is that if you want to incorporate CP violation into the standard model, you have to modify the particle content. You remember my argument yesterday before starting my course. It's not only the sentence of Young, symmetries dictate the interaction. It's that even you are obliged to change the particle content. Already, Glashow, Iliopoulos, and Bayani made with success. Here, if you want to incorporate CP violation, you need at least three families. And the three families should be active. That means it's not that in nature you have three families. No. In the process in which you observe CP violation, the three families have to participate. If not, you can reabsorb the faces. You know always that faces are very delicate. Okay. Faces factors of two and pies and signs also, but in particular faces in quantum mechanics. You see, all these errors in the history of quantum mechanics, whether faces were observable or not observable, depending what you can measure, because at the end you find an interference experiment in something that you thought that was unobservable at the end. For example, the famous rotation of 2π for the fermionic states, that there is a -1, and people said this is nonsense. Okay, if it's a 2π rotation, it's nonsense, the -1. This is unobservable, this phase of the -1. No. This phase exists, is physical, and is observed. You see, with neutron interference experiments, at the end you discover that there is a -1. That means you have to distinguish what is 2π rotation in ordinary space from a 2π rotation in the space of the states of quantum mechanics. And you remember that always I have discussed this point. Okay, anyway, the situation is that you need this. Already in 1977, at Fermilab, Lederman discovered the upsilon meson. You see, composed of the B quarks, third family already. Similar, you see, the upsilon family is like the Charmonium family in the case of the Char, in that case. And after this, and with all the results of the B system after 2000, I have put only here a sentence of this. We have evidence in 2018 that all observed phenomena on CP violation can be interpreted in terms of the Kabibo-Kobayashi-Maskawa mixing of three families. The Nobel Prize was given a few years ago to Kobayashi Maskawa. People were surprised why Tabibo was not included into this, because the mechanism, you see, is a generalization to three families to a mechanism that had already been discussed since 1964 by Cabibo, but I started in the gene mechanism. You have to read the sentence of this Nobel Prize. The Nobel Prize was not given for the mechanism responsible of CP violation, but for a different argument. The argument was in the Nobel Prize that if you want to incorporate CP violation into the theory, you need three families. And the Nobel Prize was given after the discovery of the three families, not for, but for the discovery of the three families associated with this observed phenomenon of CP violation. Yeah, if you put this argument, probably there was somebody in the committee that was against Cabibo. You put this argument and then Cabibo has nothing to do with this Nobel Prize, okay? Depending what you write, that really you give to one physicist to another. Sometimes it's very important not only to know what are the names, what is the reason. You see the two lines that are written for the motivation of the Nobel Prize in that case. Anyway, then you need three families, and then if you repeat the argument for the different families, then not only the B, but you should have also the top quark, okay, for this. The B is a bottom quark, and the top, the properties of the upper quarks in that case. You see, I said that all observed phenomena in particle physics are compatible with the interpretation in terms of Kobayashi-Maskawa. However, there is a sentence here at the end of the transparencies that you should remember. This is not the last word, for sure, because we know with the Sakharov conditions what are, you see, the mechanisms that you need in order to generate a matter-antimatter asymmetry in the universe. Why the present universe contains only matter, or okay, some small quantity of antimatter because of the processes that occur in the universe, but essentially matter. Okay, and you know these conditions. In the standard theory, in principle, you have this condition, but the CP violation that is generated by this mechanism is not enough in order to explain the matter-antimatter asymmetry in the universe. Okay, this is still an open problem these days, okay? You should remember this sentence at the end of this. Yes?
Do you think we have to modify the particle content to try to explain this? Or is there a way just to explain it without modifying
for explaining
the CP violation
with this kind of mechanism going to four families? You don't have any answer, a positive answer for the explanation of the universe asymmetry. No, it's not a question of the number of families in that case. Could be perhaps, okay, one in the phenomenon of baryogenesis. You see, in theories beyond the standard model, normally you have a B minus L, a B minus L exact conservation, lepton number, global lepton number, and the baryonic lepton number. That means that perhaps is not coming the origin of the matter-antimatter asymmetry in the universe from the quarks, from the baryons, baryonic number, but it's coming from the leptons, neutrinos. We have many unknowns still in the neutrino. Tomorrow I will talk a little bit on this question for neutrinos. And then this is what is called, instead of baryogenesis, leptogenesis. That means that you have, you see, this asymmetry from leptons. And then in the evolution of the system, when you have a phase transition in which B minus L has to be conserved, this information of having a lepton number, which is definite, that means it's not zero, the total lepton number, particles and antiparticles, then it's transmitted to the baryons. Okay? This is a phenomenon that is called leptogenesis, very promising, but there is no evidence, no experimental evidence in favor of that. But it's in the market, okay, let us put it. Coming from completely different origin to explain the matter antimatter to the asymmetry of the universe. Okay, I said that you need three families, okay? If you have three families, not only you have the big one, but also the top. The top is a very important component. I prepare a transparency for the top because the top presents certain properties that go beyond anything that you can think associated to the other quarks, to all other quarks. Okay, in fact, it's the most massive fundamental, elementary constituent of matter that exists in nature. You see, the mass of the top is 170 GeV. 170 GeV for an elementary constituent. This is like the mass of a heavy atom. Okay? The mass of the heavy atom, okay, this number corresponds to the mass of the top, which is an elementary constituent. The decay of the top quark is immediate, okay? Is because of the SU2 structure that I have shown, the top decays to the B and the W. Okay, essentially, okay, not 100% probability, but 98% probability. Because of the Kabibo Kobayashi Maskawa mixing, you have some probability to other channels different from the B, but okay, mainly to this channel. The lifetime is 10 to the minus 25 seconds. When I got my professorship in Valencia, and I gave the first courses on elementary particles, the first lesson was, okay, how when you look to the orders of magnitude associated with cross sections and lifetimes, then automatically you could say, okay, this process is a strong interaction, electromagnetic interaction, weak interaction, orders of magnitude. This is very odd. This is a weak interaction decay with a lifetime, 10 to the minus 25 seconds, which is a lifetime shorter than the decay of the delta into the pi nucleon, the resonance. We call this a resonance, okay, in that case. That means this is very odd. This is so short, this lifetime, 10 to the minus 25 seconds, that really there is no time in the decay of the top for the hadronization. The typical time which is associated with this process that I commented yesterday with the jets of hadrons, associated with a strong interaction, okay, is many orders of magnitude larger than this. That means you cannot think in terms of top quarks dressed into a hadron which contains top. This cannot exist. There is no time with this lifetime to have hadronization. This is very interesting because it's the only quark that really you can study the properties of the bare quark, not of the quark confined into a hadron, which is always a problem. This is a problem for the people that study, okay, hadron physics. In the case of the top, there is no hadron physics. You see, you can study the properties of the top quark bare. The first arguments experimentally in favor of the top quark, beyond the question of the three families of the Kobayashi-Maskawa argument for CP violation, these first arguments were coming from virtual effects of the top quark, using something that I already commented, that in loop effects, in which you have longitudinal Ws, then automatically you generate the mass of the top in the numerator. Okay? It's the non-decoupling effect. And in fact, before LEP even, You see, in the U1 experiment with the antiproton proton collider that I mentioned, and later in Argus, that was an argument in Doris, the plasminos and Daisy, they studied the mixing between the B0 and the B0 bar. That means the equivalent to the mixing between K0 and K0 bar that I mentioned before. Then now with the B, you can repeat this B0, B0 bar mixing. Again, the box diagram. And then when you put the top, then the S mixing is very big. Okay, it's very big. It's small because this is a loop, it's a diagram, but what I said before, that there is a gene suppression, in this case is not suppression. Is the mass of the top compared with the mass of the W is much larger, the mass of the top, than the mass of the W. Okay, that means it's enhanced, the contribution. You see, the enhancements in such a way that really that was the first argument to say that the top had to be very heavy in order to understand this mixing. Okay, that was before LEP. Then in LEP, you see, you could study also with the longitudinal Zs. You see the Bellman contribution to the self-energy, which is a universal effect. That means it's independent of what is the fermion that put, the plus and minus in the initial state at LEP, and in the final state, or whatever is the fermion. That means in all cases, you have this loop here. And when you put the top, then automatically there are effects proportional to the mass of the top. And you see, with my former students, Antonio and Santa Maria, we also found that there is a specific to the decay channel of the Z going to BB bar, that also there is a contribution virtually of the top curve with this enhanced effect. I mean, these were, this, in the three cases that was measured, I said before LEP, and these other contributions were measured at LEP. In fact, in the case of the vertex of the Z going to BB bar, this goes in the literature under the name of RB. That means there is a decay amplitude, which is modified for the case of the B, different from the S and the D quark. Okay? That means the B, the S, and the. And always is with the partner. Eh? You remember the argument of the gene mechanism, that here is the same. It's always with the partner. Okay? If you are studying the Bs, then you need the properties of the top. Here the Bs, and the property. Here is universal. Okay? In the case of the Bellman effect, in that case. Okay? And at the end, in the LEP experiments, when people were doing these global fits in terms of the parameters of the mass of the top, the mass of the W, and perhaps the mass of the Higgs, okay, that in the standard theory you had, then again, what there was a conviction that the mass of the top was at the level of 170 GeV. Then in the Tevatron collider, P bar P at Fermilab, in 1995, at the end, they look into that region for the masses of the jets, and then, the jets of the bees, because what I'm saying, you have to reproduce that is coming all this, the bees from the top. There is no jet of the top, so I said there is no hadronization. You don't see anything associated with the top. You have to reconstruct in that way, and the argument is that you see. The Tevatron was observed as a direct production in Fermilab in 1995, you see, with the Tevatron, and the processes by a strong interaction producing TT bar, okay, because of a strong interaction you conserve the flavor. We discussed this at the beginning of the course yesterday. Flavor has to be conserved, and this is the process, is this process. With the partons of the PP bar gluon and the gluon produce the TT bar, or by weak interaction, that means with U and D bar, you have proton antiproton and the Tevatron, and then U D bar can produce singletons, TP bar. Either associated production of TT bar by strong interactions, or by weak interaction, then you produce singletons. The difference is that in this case, the tops are not polarized because that by a strong interaction. In this other case, with single tops, the tops are polarized. So you can study many interesting processes from this, which is, has a small cross, a smaller cross section than the other, but is observable, okay, using these polarized tops. Okay. Perhaps it's time to have a break, or what do you think? Okay, then the next part is a different subject. I come again to the discrete symmetries. Okay, continuing with this. Okay,
yeah.
This is time for a break.
I'm ready for coffee.
Thank you very much.
And questions, maybe, if you want.
Yeah, I have water here. Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. There was an argument by Vicky Washkoff that the fermions were discovered in the United States and all the bosons were discovered in Europe. With one exception, of course, okay? The electron. The electron was discovered in Britain. Okay? But the history of particle physics has been like that. The interactions discovered in Europe, the particles, the elementary particles, apart from the electron, in the States. In fact, probably you appreciate that everything started really with the Gargamel effect. Before that, people were, I remember, you see, I was at that moment the PhD student and so on, before, you see, around the 1970s. And the standard model, if you see citations of the papers by Glashow, Weinberg and Salam was in 1967. Okay, Salam in 1968. Glashow before, but Glashow was only one part of the construction of that. You see, people were not considering the standard model. From the theoretical point of view, it was the demonstration by Topf that this theory was renormalizable. And from the point of view of the attitude of the scientific community was the Gargamel spread. Everything started with that.
okay, we can resume.
Okay, good. Then we come again to, remember we have studied parity, charge conjugation, CP, time reversal, okay? In the study of CPT, the combination of the three in that case. What is time reversal? It's a very delicate transformation because the time is not reverse, okay? There is an arrow of time that was already explained almost 100 years ago in the late 20s by Eddington and others, that really is a question of the entropy in the universe. The time is always running in the positive sense. Time reversal is a bad name. In fact, I remember John Bell saying English is a disaster as a language for physics. He was British. He was from Ireland, the North Ireland. And because people think that really you are reversing the time. The time cannot be reversed, okay? And instead of saying time reversal, that is the normal wording for that, he always repeated reversal in time, not reversal of time. You see, in English you don't put the prepositions and then automatically you don't know what you are reversing. And I repeat it, not reversing time, okay? You are reversing the sense of the evolution of the system in time, okay? In time, okay. Now you understand what this. A symmetry transformation in which you change the sense of the evolution of the system is what is called, you see how I write, is called time reversal, which is a bad name, very bad name. What happens? Time reversal has to be in the implementation of this transformation in the space of states in quantum mechanics has to be an anti-unitary operator, you see, in the Wigner argument. And this is very clear, you see, quantum mechanics has a property of the correspondence principle for the commutation between the position and the momentum operators. If you change the sign of P and you don't change the sign of X, then the commutator is changing sign. This is not quantum mechanics. The commutator has to be the same before and after the transformation. It's a transformation within the theory of quantum mechanics. Okay, what is the solution? You change the sign of the commutator. This is not quantum mechanics anymore. That means you start from quantum mechanics, you make this transformation, and you go to something which has nothing to do with quantum mechanics. What is the solution? You have to conjugate, because this commutator has an I. And if you conjugate, then you compensate the change of sign. Okay? And with this conjugation of the I, then automatically you remain in quantum mechanics. That means this transformation has to be anti-unitary. I don't know any argument simpler than that in order to explain, okay? You see, you go to the books of quantum mechanics and then to explain that time reversal is anti-unitary, there are pages and pages in order to have that. And I think with the argument of the commutator, it's trivial. Has to be anti-unitary. Okay? That means unitary for the conservation of probabilities and antilinear. That means that when you have this transformation of a linear combination, you always have to conjugate when you pass in terms of that. Antilinear. That means this antilinear is not an observable. That means there is nothing like conserved time reversal. There is no sense. You can say whether time reversal is invariant or is not invariant. But conservation, non-conservation is not the correct wording associated with time reversal. There is nothing to be conserved in this case of this transformation. Okay, and then because of this anti-unitary, character of the 10 reversal operator, then you have to exchange when you want to make a test of 10 reversal. You have to exchange initial and final states. Okay, and here you have this, you know very well, no, the Galileo experiment and the legend that Galileo is here. Okay, as you see, the stone, and you see what is the evolution of the stone. Okay, with the initial velocity zero to the final velocity, and you see here the bottom. What is time reversal? Time reversal is a property in which you consider the trajectory, the evolution of the system, in which is inverting the velocity, the momentum, okay, minus Vf, okay, in the other sense. And you have to see whether this evolution, changing the sense, really with this velocity, in this sense, the stone comes again to the hands of Galileo. Okay? At zero velocity. Okay? You take this. Okay, that means you have to have this exchange between initial and final states. And this is very intriguing, because using this kind of argument with the exchange, then Wolfenstein repeated and repeated for many years that in the case of decaying particles, you cannot have a test, a true test of time reversal, because you cannot change the sense of the evolution in a decaying system. You see, the decay process is an irreversible process. You cannot reverse. Because of that, if you have in mathematical terms, even Wolfenstein stated the following, we were commenting this before, if you have a decaying particle and you apply the time reversal operator, the result is not a physical state. Means you cannot do it. What is the problem? The problem is that, okay, you, because CP violation has been observed in particles that decay, because of the CPT theorem in quantum field theory, you should expect in these systems, which correspond to decaying particles, to have time reversal violation too. But you are telling me that it's impossible to do an experiment with this, not an experiment, let us put, it's impossible to have a true test of time reversal using these decaying particles. Is there any solution? Okay, the first point is you should consider a time reversal asymmetry in order to make a test which is not including the decay objects. That means that you should consider the time evolution of the particle before the decay. And then talk the language of transition probabilities between, for example, in the case of the kaon, the neutral kaon, from a state of the neutral kaon to another state of the neutral kaon. But this is not observed. What you observe is the decay. And then you need a second step. Not only not including in the asymmetry the decaying particles, but you should have a theory which is able to tell you from the observed decay what is the state of the particle that was decaying in which you have a projection of the wave packet. That means a tag of the state, a tagging procedure. Okay? The other is that if the particle has decayed, has disappeared, then you cannot repeat in the same conditions under the same conditions in the other sense. You needed the same stone, okay, in this experiment. Okay. At the end, there is a solution. The first is a question of choice. I consider the asymmetry in the transition probabilities. The second is something that started this argument with, I think it was already in the 70s or something like that. And later we developed how it's possible to define what is the projected state of the system before, not before, just at the moment of the decay. Okay, that means like the projection that you have in the measurement process in quantum mechanics. And the third is that, okay, it's true that you cannot use the same particle because it has disappeared. But there are systems in which, in quantum mechanics, you have entanglement, in which you have a particle and another particle that really, talking about the characterization of the states in one of them, automatically the information is transferred to the partner. In fact, this is fantastic. This is the EPR argument, Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen argument. You see, before I started with the problem in philosophy, okay, whether quantum mechanics was complete because really you cannot say what was the reality of each of the parts of the system. Then John Bell demonstrated that it's not philosophy, it's physics. Okay, there is this Bell inequalities that really can demonstrate whether this is a physical situation or not. You don't need you see hidden variables in order to have a theory in which there is a local reality. Then it came the experiments proving the Bell inequalities, that quantum mechanics are violating these Bell inequalities, okay? And then it came a technological field these days with the quantum computing, quantum information, okay, which is technology. Okay, but here is fundamental, you will see. This automatically solves the problem of Wolfenstein. As I said, you have to use the decay in order to define what is the state of the particle at the moment of the decay. You see, the tag. And the second is the entanglement. And there is a situation in which this happens with the B measures. You go to a B factory, E plus E minus, at the epsilon 4s peak, and the epsilon 4s produce the B0, B0 bar. This B0, B0 bars are entangled. You cannot say what is a B0 and B0 bar. They are entangled. Okay? The Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen argument, and you see, you cannot put a line. In that case, this is the B0, the other is the B0 bar. There is a correlation. If you know that one is B0, the other has to be B0 bar. But before any measurement, okay, this is the kind of entangled state that you have. And then you observe at time t1, you observe first decay, for example, a semi-leptonic decay, L plus. And then automatically, if you observe L plus, I think is correct what I'm saying here, if not you change what is particle and antiparticle, then this projects the B0, which means that the partner at that time, T1, is a B0 bar, the B0 bar tag. Then you let the system evolve with time, the partner. The partner is still living. Okay? I mean, no problem. And I study the time evolution of this partner. And then after a certain time, delta T, let us use the language of quantum mechanics. At time t1, I have prepared the state of the B0 bar. And then, after a time delta t, I observe that there is a decay, for example, to a CP eigenstate, j psi k long or j psi k short. In this case, I have put j psi k short. And then, you can demonstrate that under certain conditions, there is a CP tag. In the same way that in this case I have a B0, B0 bar, that flavor tag. You see, if I observe a CP eigenstate in the final state, I have a CP tag, and I can say what is the corresponding state at time t2 that is protected by this measurement. That measurement is the decay. Quantum mechanics 100% in all these arguments. Okay? This projection. And this is a combination of B0 and B0 bar that is called B minus, for example. Okay, because this CP eigenstate is minus, okay, there is a CP tag. A combination of B0, B0 bar, B minus. That means if I consider for the time reversal study the time evolution of the system from T1 to T2, I forget what happened before T1. And I forget what happened after T2. That means just the time evolution of the system from the prepared state, V0 bar, to the detected state, the decay, V minus. And this is a transition that is from V0 bar to V minus. What is time reversal? In that case, it's very clear what is time reversal. No problem. The time reversal, you see, this transparency has to be seen, you see, from top to down in the, in the left part. Now you come here. What is time reversal? Time reversal is very clear. It's change initial and final state. I have to prepare a V minus and detect a V0 bar and see the time evolution of the system from V minus to V0 bar. And then I go bottom up, okay, in this transparency. What is experimentally this transition V minus to V0 bar? Here, there is no problem of interpretation. This is time reversal, okay, from this to that, in this transition. But I have now to discover experimentally what is what you have to do in order to consider a transition which is V minus to V0 bar. Do you follow me? Okay. First, I look for events in which first there is a CP tag. But in order to have a preparation of the V minus, I have to observe the V plus. Okay, in the decay. That means, okay, this is against the intuition. If I had observed J psi K short later in the first process, in here, in the time reverse process, I have to observe first the J psi K long, not the J psi K short, okay? Because the preparation is the preparation of the partner of the particle that decays, okay? This is the V minus. Then the time evolution with the same delta T, and then again, I have to observe L minus if before I had observed L plus here, in order to tag a flavor state that corresponds to V0 bar. That means, from the experimental point of view, this is very difficult to understand that this configuration in a B factory is the time reverse of this other configuration. You see, that was the PhD thesis of Marie-Carmen Banyuls. And in 1999, there was a meeting at Orsay in which Wolfenstein and myself were there. And I explained this to Wolfenstein. When I explained this to Wolfenstein, he looked to me 1 minute, and I realized that he understood better than me immediately. Immediately. Okay, he was repeating for years that, you see, time reversal is impossible for decaying states. And after this conversation, okay, then he wrote immediately, this appears to be a true time reversal violating defect. You see, definitive in that case. You see, with the Neil Ostad or Wolfenstein, in that case. Okay, the only thing that is needed here, I'm not going to explain the next transparency, perhaps to say that what I'm saying here about the tax you can do in quantum mechanics. The formulation, the mathematical formulation is here, you see, in this transparency. First, the entangled state. In the entangled state, you see, you have an epsilon 4s, which is C minus V0, V0 bar from the decay of the epsilon 4s. Okay, that means it's particle-antiparticle. Okay, particle and antiparticle, we know since the time of Dirac, that correspond to identical particles. The only thing is that when you say that you have to make a permutation in order to see the properties of these, of the two particles, identical particles, you have to change also the charge, okay, in that case. The particles and antiparticles that are described by the same field in quantum field theory, or by the same spinor, or whatever, or not as a spinor, you see a spin one effect in that case. In the case of the P0, P0 bar, spin zero and spin zero, okay? Particles and antiparticles are identical. That means they are boson. The state has to be symmetric under the exchange of the two particles. But the exchange, I said, is permute and charge conjugation, because it's particle antiparticle. The charge conjugation is minus, that means under permutation of B0, B0 bar has to be antisymmetric. Okay, and this is what is written here. This is what you have originally. And then if you rewrite the B0, B0 bar in terms of the states of the B0 with definite mass, because of the mixing, then you have the BH and the that means the heavy and the light. The H and the L. You see, in the case of K0, you were distinguishing K long, K short with the lifetime. Here, the lifetimes essentially of the two states are the same because these are heavy particles and there is no difference between the decay to 2 pions or 3 pions in phasor space or whatever, or the corresponding decays. That means normally the notation is the heavy and the light, of these two. And this is also antisymmetric. And in the time evolution, I said, you forget, I mentioned, and this is very important, what happens before the first decay. And you can forget this because this, you see, is a stationary state. These are states of definite mass, it's antisymmetric. Okay, that means the time evolution is trivial of the system. Okay, that means at all times it's antisymmetric. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what was the time of the decay of the upsilon. You forget what happened before the first decay of the B, because even at that time, T1 is antisymmetric. Okay? Is antisymmetric. I mean, the first thing that I said, you forget what happened before the first decay. It's here. The second is that I said, there is, okay, I think this filtering identity is not mine, okay? This, I think, was my good friend Botella. And that's it. What you are saying is that there is an identification of what is the state. This is the tag that I was talking about. And in fact, when you observe a decay, then what you know immediately is what is the state that has zero probability to go to this final state. That means what is the state of the bit that cannot decay to the Z. You see, the decay amplitude is these A's and for the B0 and A bar for the B0 bar, this particular combination has zero probability to decay to this. And that means this is the zero probability is that of the partner precisely, the one that you have to, because you have observed one particular decay to F and I said, I have to go to the partner. It's precisely this one. That means I know very well how to prepare the state of the B, the initial state of the B, okay? Looking for the final decay products. And then the last thing is this transition probability has to be connected to what you observe in the experiment. And what you observe in the experiment are two decays, at time T1 and time T2, double decay rate. This goes in the literature under the name of the double decay rate. And this is the expression. You put the branching ratios, whatever are the factors, whatever you want, corresponding to these decays, in order to connect what is observed in the experiment with what is theoretically the good concept in order to build the asymmetry, which is the transition probability from one prepared state to the other state. Okay? That means this transparency just to show that this interpretation of the figure could be done. Then the next. The next is there is. There is a question. Okay.
See, can you go back to your slide, the one that shows the Babar experiment? Two slides before this.
You
one.
Want to see the results of the Babar experiment?
No, no, no. Ah. The if you can go back two slides before this one.
I come back. Yes. Or the other.
No, the other one.
Another one.
Okay. In the second part.
Yes.
in the top, when you identify the B...
Coming from theory to experiment. No?
Yes.
Okay.
When you do the tag of the B plus, how do you know that...
Plus and minus has nothing to do with the
charges. Okay.
The charges you put at the... You see upper index.
Okay.
Well, in the CP plus, CP minus.
Yes. In the first case, you know that because you have a positive charged lepton, you have a B0.
Yeah.
Okay? Yeah. So the other one is a B0 bar.
A B0 bar.
And in the second part, you identify the decay the at the tagging point, B plus, because you have a J psi and a K long. But the K long decays after not at the point T1, but later. Okay?
No, because but it doesn't matter. You reconstruct, what matters is the decay of the B. You have to reconstruct from the decays of the K long. In fact, they don't do the K long in the case of Babar by the decay of the K long, but by a strong interaction. Okay? That means what is the interaction of this neutral kaon with the system, which is different for K short and K long. In the case of K-short, the definition of K-short is 2 pions.
Okay.
You forget 1 per mil. The 1 per mil that I mentioned before, that the 2 pions is K-short, okay, for the experiment. In the case of the K-long, they identify K-longs from the interaction with the system. But the time in that case plays no role, because the time that matters is the decay of the B in J-psi K-long. Okay? That means you have to know that the event is a K-long. And the decay took place, you see, at the point of this. Okay, you have to reconstruct the K-long, but this is the experiment.
So there is no time evolution for K-long.
There is no time evolution for the K-long.
Okay.
The only time, in fact, this, you see, this kind of concepts. I have been with this at this moment 19 years. Okay, 19 years since the 99, and you see, in several occasions. I had this confusing situation. I remember a question by my good friend Apostolos Pilaxis. But tell me, what is in what region of the time interval you are doing the time reversal test? Okay, I'm thinking and thinking. That, okay, because you do the mathematics and you do the formulas, but then you have to understand what you are doing. Now it's very clear. You see, it's delta t. Is then the time evolution of the particle that survives after the first decay. Okay? It's delta T, you see. Here in the theory for the asymmetry, very clear. This is the test of this. Hmm? Okay? You see, whatever happens with the K-long is only that in the experiment you had to reconstruct that it was a K-long. Okay, then, you see, this experiment was thought in the case of B0, B0 bar, for transitions, as I said, flavor CP eigenstate. And it happens that you have two states of flavor, L plus, L minus, two states of CP, J psi K long, J psi K short. And there is also two time orders. That means, what is the first decay? The one of the CP, or the one of the leptonic decay, okay? The time ordering. 2 times 2 times 2 is 8, okay? That means there are 8 different double decay ratios that you can measure. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. That means, okay, it's here, okay? L plus, L minus, okay? J psi K long, J psi K short, in both time orderings in one case and the other. Or 8 double decay rates that you can measure. And there is another interesting thing, is that if you sit, for example, in one of them, okay, I don't know whether this is the transition that I mentioned before, doesn't matter. One of them, okay, for example, this one. And then you see what is the CP transformation. The CP transformation, you come to this transition. What is the T transformation, and that I explained two transparencies before, okay, and it's this one. You can consider also CPT transformation, okay, which is also anti-unitary because of the T. I mean, the only thing is that not only you exchange initial and final state, but you have to put particles to antiparticles in that case, the comparison. And then CPT is from here to there. That means I have four different processes in which I can have completely separate tests without any prejudice of CPT and CPT independently, without assuming anything about CPT invariants or whatever, quantum field theory argument. No, I have here the possibility of having separate independent tests of CPT, CPT. You see, the change of the time ordering that is present here has nothing, in coming from here to there, from the red to the blue in the transparency, there is no symmetry transformation. It's only time ordering. And the time ordering of the two decays has, the time ordering of two decays has nothing to do with time reversal or whatever. Okay? The time reversal we already discovered was that. Okay? This time ordering, originally in the entangled state, in the EPR state, is like the exchange of B0, B0 bar. That means if, in coming from this region, from this other region, if you make a test, is of the Pauli principle. Okay, not the Pauli, because these are bosons, but the exchange symmetry theory. Okay? Because it's the exchange, okay, the first decay, the second decay, then you change the order of the decays in that case. Anyway, you have, apart from this question of the exchange, two different ways of having separate tests of CPT and CPT. In order to make these arguments, and I was reluctant to make a definite calculation using Wigner, Weisskopf, and whatever is effective Hamiltonian for the evolution of the system, because these tests, as Wolfenstein wanted, are independent of any theory, on any framework for describing the time evolution and whatever. Nothing. I was reluctant to that. But people were thinking, okay, but we should at the end put this in terms of the parameters that correspond to that, to the Wigner-Weisskopf theory and things like that. And then, okay, I wanted to demonstrate that is independent of the theory. It's a test of the symmetry, nothing else. You are not putting any theory in that case. These are the experimental results of the Babar experiment, okay, for the case of time reversal. You could do also, as I said, CP and CPT. And the result is then when you combine, you see the difference. You put the lines here, but it's not to guide the eye with these lines, but it's not necessary to put the lines, okay? You see that there is an asymmetry between, okay, for example, in this case, B minus B0 compared with B0, B minus in that case. Originally zero is built in the time evolution of the system, the asymmetry. That means it's true time reversal, okay? It's in the time evolution, it's motion reversal, okay? It's zero at the beginning, and then you see this line, which is not zero at all times, is the zero in the experiment. You know that the zero in the experiment is not the mathematical zero in that case, because there are always backgrounds and things like that, okay? And then this dotted line is the one that corresponds to the zero. And this is fantastic. You put all these things, the first experiment about a test of time reversal violation, you see with positive results and a statistical significance of 14 sigma. And there are two arguments by two people, one experimentalist who is the spokesman of Katrin, and this experiment, which is already taking data these days. Katrin, okay, for measuring the absolute mass, that in a colloquium in Karlsruhe that I gave to the General University, he said, I was thinking that there was something wrong. The first experiment could not have 14 sigma. 14 sigma is too much. You see, normally for experiments of this kind, when you arrive to 5 sigma, then it's, he said, now I understand. The problem was not in the experiment. The problem was in knowing what you had to measure. Okay, that means two transparencies before. Also, Rubakov, a theorist, made an argument similar to that. because 14 sigma is impressive, without using any theory. Even more, then after some time, then I was convinced that we could make a theoretical analysis using the Wigner-Weiss in order to interpret the decay, the time evolution of the system, the effective Hamiltonian, and so on. And then recently, okay, a couple of years ago, okay, with Botella and Nebot, we made this kind of analysis. And you see, the quantities that matter for any of the three symmetries, CPT or CPT, are these delta coefficients in the double decay rate. Okay, let me come again to the previous, not the previous, but two transparencies before, probably. Okay, let me see. Yes, here. You see the double decay rate there. And the general evolution, without putting in a theory, is only the fact that you have a Hamiltonian in terms of that, but you don't say what is the Hamiltonian, anything. And this is parameterized in terms of these coefficients of the time evolution of the system, the delta t's. And then you have the cosine term, the sine term, the hyperbolic cosine, and the hyperbolic sine. In fact, for the case of the B0, B0 bar, the last term doesn't exist, because delta gamma is zero, essentially. Okay, in that case. That means that you have three coefficients in which you can compare the double decay rate for one of these intensities that you have there compared with the other. These are the deltas that I put in the other transparency. That means one and two. These are the deltas, and you have three coefficients. Okay? And then you have not only three coefficients, but three symmetries to be tested. That means that you have nine asymmetry parameters which have different information properties. And then from the experimental results that were measured by the Babar experiment in 2012, it was published, the paper. The published was paper in November, but the Economist made practically four pages dedicated to that 2 months before, in September. There was a filtration of this. And these people of the Economist are very good, much before Nature and the other magazines. Okay, anyway, when you make this kind of analysis with the detailed theory, then you calculate these asymmetry parameters independently for CP and for T, as I said. And for the sine term, the result is conclusive. Okay, the delta S term, the sine term, for the T asymmetry, okay, is at this level, which is 30 sigmas, not 14. I mean, when you put theory into the question, then really you constrain more the analysis, not only the experiment. And for the CP, these are the results independently, as I said. You had different comparisons of transition. Okay, what happens is that they are compatible, the two numbers, but this is nature. Okay, this is nature. Nature means that this asymmetry has the same value essentially for CP and for T. We made also the analysis for CPT, as I said, and in that case for the cosine terms, because in the case of the CPT, the dominated term, the one that has more information, is the cosine term, as is written here, is at this level, which is essentially two sigma. Okay, two sigma is a statistical fluctuation. You have, it's not necessary to put more, and it's represented here, what is this. And you see, this is interesting because this CPT violation in this transition has been observed in a B factory that, okay, CPT violation has been, what has been observed is that it's compatible with zero, the symmetry in that case, but in a B factory in which really you can make this exchange of initial and final state, it's anti-unitary CPT. But happens that in the theoretical analysis, the same term that is violating CPT also violates CP. And that means that for CP, you don't need entanglement and all this. You compare particles and antiparticles, and there is no exchange of initial and final particles in that case. That means that this kind of test here can be done at LHCb at present. Okay? I think this is understood. And this analysis was made putting not four processes, but the eight processes. That means we assume that the exchange symmetry, that means two different ways of measuring the same quantity, believing the Stein symmetry that I mentioned before. Because as a consequence of this Stein symmetry in the comparison, the cosine terms for the two orderings have to be the same, and the sine terms have to be opposite, okay, because of that. Any questions? If not, let me conclude the session of today, coming again to the standard theory of electroweak interaction. Once you have this test of the symmetries, I think it's interesting to see whether the theory in which all these discussions are based for that is consistent. There is a problem. The problem is, again, you see, a quantum anomaly. That means when you have the classical theory for the electroweak interactions, we have built the Lagrangian, we have the symmetry, and we have all these properties. But it's a chiral theory. This is different. This is something that is not occurring in the case of QCD. This is a chiral theory. That means that you have left and right-handed fermions in the loops in the quantum theory. That means that if you put the left-handed component and the right-handed component, it's this equivalent to say that you have vector and axial vector couplings. And then, in general, when you have this kind of loops in the chiral theories, in the chiral gauge theories, then the theory is not renormalizable. Okay, and the question is, in general, I think I have put here what are the conditions. What is important is for dimension four, but okay, some works have worked the situation in general for D dimension. But for D equal four, you see, when you have three vertices in the loop, then vector, vector, axial, then this anomaly happens. And it comes from the fact that you can, I think I already commented at some moment, that you cannot follow the same renormalization program when you have this at the same time for the vector and the axial vector vertices for the couplings. Okay, that means that if you put here left-handed and right-handed fermions, DVA, in the loop, that I'm considering this, or and this in the quantum version of the electroweak theory, then there is an anomaly. Anomalies have been observed in particle physics, because here in the theory, this is, you see, a contribution which is coming from three currents, okay? Whatever are these currents of the electroweak theory. In some cases, you don't have three currents. For example, if you put here up and down quarks, these vertices can be considered to be the representative of the pi zero. And the pi zero to two gamma precisely decays because of the anomaly. You know probably the history that Jack Steinberger started in his life of a physicist as a theorist. And in the late 40s, he made the calculation of this loop for the pi zero going to two gammas, putting nucleons. At that time, there were no quarks or anything. Okay? The pi zero putting the nucleons in the loop. And he got a result different from zero. And he's fantastic in the way that he's discussing his history, his life in that case. Then when I said that the result was different from zero, what is called the anomaly for the pi zero going to two gamma, then there was a revolution of all the theorists in the world. Something had to be wrong, okay? Because this result different from zero is anomalous, okay? And then it's, and then people started to talk about the anomalies and what happens, and that there is a, you have to put nucleons, you have to put any fermions, it doesn't matter what you put in the loop, but at the end you have only the contribution of the anomaly. And then after a certain time, he had already the title of a doctor in physics, okay? He decided, this is not for me, I'm going to experiment, okay? I mean, he moved from theory to experiment because of his result, which was correct, but he was unable to understand this, okay? The anomaly has been observed. But this is not the point. The point is when you have here three currents in a loop, Okay, this anomaly makes that the theory is not renormalizable, and then there is a problem. Okay, is there any solution? This is like the three families of Kobayashi-Maskawa, okay, in order to solve the situation of the CP violation. Here is the opposite. You want to save the theory. Okay, and then what is interesting is that when you put a loop, you have to put all fermions in the loop, all, not one. One is anomalous. Okay, but you have to put all. And then you may study what is the condition in order to have a cancellation of this anomaly in the loop coming from the contribution of different fermions. The condition, okay, in general in the couplings is like that, but happens that the cancellation has to come between, you see, quarks and leptons in the loop. You see, both quarks and leptons have electroweak interactions. That means that no problem with this, okay? And a strong interaction only quarks, but in electroweak interactions, leptons and quarks. And when you put this condition, okay, that there should be a cancellation, if you know that you have three families of quarks, then automatically you need three families of leptons with properties of the charges. That means of the couplings to the charges in electroweak theory, of the couplings to the different mediators of electroweak interactions, of the leptons and the quarks that are related. Means, in a sense, you need a connection, a symmetry between quarks and leptons. Up to the year 2018, experimentally, we don't have any evidence of this connection. But this was the argument. The cancellation of the chiral gauge anomalies in the electroweak theory for the grand unified theories, in which you unify the world of quarks with the quark with the world of the leptons. A symmetry between quarks and leptons. This is for the young people, okay, for the future, and to see what happens in connection and with this symmetry that has to exist, that is built in the standard theory, but by fixing what are the couplings relating the couplings of the quarks to the coupling of the leptons. What is the symmetry, the grand unified symmetry, in which really you put together this connection between quarks and leptons? This is beyond the standard model in the grand unified theory. I finish here for today. Okay. Okay. This is the program for tomorrow. If you want to know what is the menu that you will get tomorrow, that is related now, I think it's time to go to the field of neutrinos, okay? Starting with Pauli in 1930.
Okay. So there's time for some questions. Who wants to ask?
Questions? Oh, what happens? Yesterday there was a very, very live. Yeah. Okay.
I got a bit lost with the definition of A sub T, the asymmetry in time. So what's the definition exactly of AT in these plots, AT versus delta T?
In this plot, which plot are you referring to?
Three slides.
The eight processes. Okay, in which you have separate in the transitions for CPT and CPT. You are referring to that, no?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, I put it.
So that one. Well, in fact, the next one. The next slide.
One?
Yeah, the next slide.
Next one is the experimental result.
Right, but how did they define A sub T? The y-axis.
One, you see, these are different, starting from different ones. T zero bar going to be minus.
Right.
Okay, then it's time reversal compared to the other, the symmetry, okay?
But this is
the asymmetry in the double decay rate from the experiment. Here there is no analysis in the sense of the next transparency that I mentioned, okay? That means this one in which I separate the symmetry parameters of the coefficients. These are numbers in this transparency. In the previous transparency in the experiment, because there was no theory, in that case is the asymmetry in the time evolution.
Okay.
Okay. Here is already in a given theory, okay, what are the asymmetry parameters in that case? And it's a different thing. Here is then the time evolution of the system. That means the complete asymmetry in one case. In this you start from a different transition, two different decay rates.
I see.
Yeah? Okay. You understand?
Yeah.
Okay, thank no, you. Continue.
You no, have no, a, thank you, thank you.
It's clear.
It's
no?
Clear.
Okay, thank you.
He wants to measure it better at Bell 2.
So
to what?
Yeah, he wants to measure it again with better precision at Bell 2. Ah, that's why he's asking.
Of course. Bell 2 is starting already. Okay? Bell 2 is the right place to look for this effect, but not only for T, CPT. I repeat, CPT, there is nothing at the level of quantum mechanics that forbids the violation of CPT. Nothing. The CPT theorem is a theorem in quantum field theory. And you know that in this quantum field theory, you have assumptions, not only Lorentz invariants that really, okay, you can think it's a, you are assuming that you have locality of the interactions. This is precisely the idea of the gauge theories, okay? That there is no action at a distance, okay? It's only locally. You have a mediator of the interaction. To me, I think this assumption points in mathematics, fantastic, in physics, probably is a very good approximation, but locality of the interaction is an assumption for the CPT theorem. If there is, you see, an effect of the interaction in an interval around this, whatever is a fundamental length, let us put like that. We have fundamental action, h bar, fundamental velocity, c. Up to now, no fundamental length has been seen. If there is a fundamental length, then automatically locality is broken, locality of the interaction. That means you cannot penetrate before this length. In the same way that you cannot penetrate in actions that are smaller than h bar, okay? Uncertainty principle and things like that. I think this assumption of locality is CPT, in my opinion, is in the air. And tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, I will conclude that I think the great revolution in fundamental physics will come in the future from the violation of CPT. Okay. Talking about this.
Related to the CPT test, this measurement that you propose can be done much better by LHCb than by Bell 2, right?
Look, if you want a test of CPT independent of any theory, you have to do entanglement because you have to exchange initial and final state. Okay?
Yeah.
CPT is anti-unitary, like T. Depends what you want.
Yeah, the measurement
what
in
say.
The theory.
Now,
yeah.
Okay, this is without any theory, okay? Now, if you put a theory in the Wigner-Weisskopf effective Hamiltonian, the master that you put in the mixing matrix that violates CPT is also violating CP. And then through the violation of CP in the cosine term, you can look for this term in LHCp. But this is not a true test of CPT. It's you see, looking for, you see, a parameter in an effective theory which at the same time is violating CP and CPT, okay? Which is what I said in the other transparency, okay? Okay, what is that? I don't know. Here, okay? This, with the cosine terms in that case. But this in a transparency in which we have put theory. If you want to make a test of CPT, there is another test with kaons. I didn't say anything about kaons because we have the time that we have, okay? But in Chloe 2, at Daphne, which is also an entangled factory, but in that case for Kayon, not for BS, okay, they are looking for tests of time reversal and CPT similar to the ones that we discussed here. In the case of Kayons, okay, there is a small point, but it's at the level of 10 to the minus 6 or so. For time reversal, there is no problem, but for CPT, could be a problem because we expect that the effects are small anyway in the case of CPT, which is the epsilon prime. Okay? This question, what I said, the CP tag, if there is an epsilon prime, which is very small, then could be that there is a contamination. Okay? And a small contamination. And not only that, there is another test of CPT, which is very interesting, in Daphne. Right? That means with the five factory. Probably all of you know that not only a CP violation was discovered in the decay of K long 2 to pi, but few years later there was a charge asymmetry in the decay of the K long, the semi-leptonic decay of the K long. A charge asymmetry. You compare K long to definite charges in the final state and the semi-leptonic decay, and then the opposite charges. Okay. This has been observed in the decay of the K-long. K-long is very easy. It's very easy because you don't have anything to do in order to have K-longs. You produce K-zeros, and then you let the system evolve with time, and after a certain time, which is larger than the lifetime of the K-short, then you know that the system is K-long without doing anything. And then you look in the review of particle properties, and the decays of K-long, you have 2 pages, okay? Because it's very easy to study the decays of K-long, okay? You let the system evolve with time, and for long times, it's K-long. But this is not valid for K-short. The decays at K-short of the neutral K-ion are not K-short decays. At short times, you have K-short and K-long. They are entangled, and there are interference effects, and you cannot say whether it's K-short or K-long. Okay, is this entangled situation in which you cannot say which is which, okay, at short times. However, okay, with Antonio Domenico recently we have been discussing that there is a way to know in entangled factories like Daphne decays that really you tag a case short, which are short decays that are, you see, correlated. The correct word is correlated with a second decay in this EPR correlation, which is at very long times. That means if you know that there is a second decay at very long times, then you can say that at short times the first decay was a K-short. This one has to be very careful in this discussion because this looks like a violation of causality. Because you are saying that you know what happened before observing later, okay? But it's not a violation of causality. But anyway, this is still a little bit in the air. But there is a way to make a very good test of CPT. Because if you do that, then you can study the charge asymmetry of the K-short. Not in hadronic machines, but in E plus E minus in Daphne. And then look for the charge asymmetry of the K-short. The charge asymmetry of the K-short is again CP violation. But the comparison between the charge asymmetry of K-long and K-short is CPT. Not CP, but CPT. And this is very interesting because this is a semi-leptonic decay, which is the point is the tagging of the K-short in that case. But the semi-leptonic decay is very well treated in this factor. I mean, there is still a lot of discussions, quantum mechanics, symmetries, K0, K0 bar, B0, B0 bar. These systems are fantastic. I'm enthusiastic about this system. Okay.
Any last question?
That in particular, I think Bell 2 should concentrate on those studies that cannot be done at LHCb. That means in which really entanglement is a must. Entanglement is a necessary condition in order to make these observations, okay? And not only for the symmetries, and for other questions, entanglement is fantastic. For example, I think I was discussing yesterday with you, these days there is a very strong discussion about these anomalies in LHCb associated with this flavor of change in decay of the P going to K short, to K star, and two leptons. And then the comparison between electron and the muon channel. Okay, whether there is violation of universality, okay, that we mentioned in that case. You see, I think it's very important to make this test also with neutrinos, not only with electrons. Because in the case of neutrinos, you have only the contribution of the Z, not of the photon. And it's the contribution of the Z is massive, and you have these longitudinal components, and you could isolate whether these effects are, beyond the standard model coming from non-decoupling effects of the longitudinal components to something. At LHCb, you cannot do it. Because you, from LHCb in this hadronic machine, okay, in this detector, you have to reconstruct everything from the end. And if you have two neutrinos, you cannot say whether it's the decay of the B, in particular, with two neutrinos in the final state. However, Bell 2, you can do it. Because if you observe in one side a decay of the B bar, the zero bar, to something very well known, the dominant decay, and you have something which is unknown going to K star, but you know that is immediately that in one side was a B zero bar, here is a B zero. And B zero going to K star and nothing is two neutrinos. Okay, do you agree with me? I think fantastic. I mean, one has to think, okay? And not trying to compete one experiment with the other. But in some cases it's good to have two different experiments for that. But in particular, I think the good life for Bell 2 is to isolate those studies that cannot be done at LHCb. Okay? This is my argument. Okay, more questions. Grand unified theories, okay, the last transparency. I think it's important. But this is for the future. Yes.
Let me go there because we're casting.
When you talk about anomaly cancellation, the famous symmetry to relate electrons and the hadronic part, is it supersymmetry or you're talking about something else?
Related to supersymmetry, what? What is
the last slide?
Eh?
Can you put the last slide again?
Which slide? Uh-huh. This one?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
The symmetry you're looking for is, of course, not supersymmetry anymore, I guess.
You see, this kind of gauge anomalies coming from quantum effects appear in all theories. It doesn't matter whether it's supersymmetric or not, if the theory is chiral. Okay? It's chirality. Yeah? It's the fact that what I said, that the renormalization program cannot be done at the same time for vector and axial vector couplings. You could do it for axial, and then the problem, but normally we say that the anomaly is in the axial, but it's convention.
Yeah, supersymmetry.
This was already clarified. You see the chiral anomalies by John Bell. And this is really the incompatibility between vector and axial in that case. In any theory that you have chirality, then you have these anomalies. Is this the question? No.
Just supersymmetry was helping to understand this, but you really need a grand unified theory to relate to quantum
supersymmetry. Supersymmetry is good for understanding the naturalness problem, which is another quantum effect, okay, associated with the scalars, but not here for the fermions. Supersymmetry, as I said, in any theory in which you have chiral components, that means different transformation properties under the Gates group of the left and right-handed component, then you have this anomaly. The only solution that we know is the cancellation of the anomaly. That means that the particle content of the theory is in such a way that really you compensate one with the other. But this is different from the cancellation that you have in supersymmetry. In supersymmetry, the cancellation comes from the contribution of fermions versus bosons. Okay? Here the cancellation is between, you see, different particles, it doesn't matter. What happens here is in between quarks and leptons, if you want to say. But it's associated with the left and right-hand fermions. Okay? It's with fermions, chirality. Okay?
If there are no further questions, we thank Pepe again a lot.
Okay, thank you.
With each other again tomorrow at 4 p.m.
Neutrinos. Okay, what?
Yesterday the mass was caused by the how do you call it? Conformal anomaly.
Conformal anomaly.
But today, about
no, because here in the you see in the case of the electroweak theory there is no conformal. You have masses.
But the masses
are generated by a spontaneous